What is up, guys? Eric here from Real Film Reviews, bringing you another streaming recommendation video, this time for Amazon Instant Video. Amazon Instant Video, I think, is arguably the least used of the four big streaming services, which is kind of a shame because it actually has a lot of good selections, especially for movies. And I do want to share with you guys, like, the general price and things. Again, I'm never sponsored by these people. I just do these because I think that a lot of people like to stay home and watch movies, and because of that, I want them to know they're watching good movies. So, to start with, if you are just a regular person that wants to sign up for it, it's $100 for a year, and you pay it all at once. So, when you pay that $100 in January, or whatever month, you don't have to worry about it again until January. So that is nice. However, the one great thing about Amazon Prime being as I am a college student, and I'm sure some of you watching are college students, is that you can use your college email to get 6 months of free Amazon Prime. Amazon Prime gives you two-day shipping on almost every item, which is freaking amazing to start with. But you also get 6 months free of Amazon Instant Video, which is great. Now, after your free 6 months is up, then you get it at 50% off. So $50 for a whole year of Amazon Instant Video. I think it's definitely worth it. I have a lot of friends that think it's worth it. And I think that a lot of people don't know about that, especially students, because that's an extremely affordable thing where most of us only live off of Netflix. And Netflix can become dry after a certain amount of time because you feel like you've seen everything that's there to see. But this adds old HBO shows. If you don't have HBO, you can watch The Sopranos or The Wire. And along with that, they get a lot of new movies and a lot of good new movies. So now that you know the price, and if you're a student, I definitely recommend at least doing the free 6 months because it's definitely worth it to see if you like it. Plus the two-day shipping, again, is absolutely amazing if you order stuff off Amazon. So as always, I will be giving you guys 10 recommendations of movies that are available on this particular streaming service, being Amazon Instant Video, that are good and that I would recommend that you check out. The first movie that I want to recommend is one that actually came out last year. It's a movie that I did not see until this year. Had I seen it last year, it probably would have been in my top three. That is The End of the Tour. End of the Tour stars Jason Segel and Jesse Eisenberg in the two primary leads in the film, and is the story of David Foster Wallace, who is the pivotal writer of the 20th century, you could say, writing Infinite Jest, which is a book that is widely considered one of the greatest pieces of American literature of all time. Dave Lipsky from Rolling Stone is sent to interview David Foster Wallace about his book and about who he is as a person because he sort of was a hermit. And this is just literally a story of two guys going on a road trip to his last book tour event and just having conversations about life and what they believe in and who they are. And this movie is so good. It's so riveting. This movie would have been an A+ for me if I would have done a review for it, if I would have seen it when it came out. It's so good. And it has just such human characters in it. I know that they're based on real people, but Jesse Eisenberg and Jason Segel really embody the two people that they're playing, and they feel so real throughout this film. It is a sad movie, because as you find out in the beginning, David Foster Wallace committed suicide. He did not live a life that most people would consider happy, even though he was filled with his successes in his life. And I think that this movie is so good because of that. This movie is about a man who was troubled, but was also so talented in everything that he did. And if you like biopics or movies about people that lived, or if you want to watch this movie because you're thinking about reading Infinite Jest, definitely check this out. This movie is amazing. The next movie on the list is another one that came out last year. That is Ex Machina, starring Alicia Vikander, Domhnall Gleeson, and Oscar Isaac. This movie is about a tech engineer who works for a big company, and he wins this contest from the CEO to come out to his private estate and spend a week with him. Now, when he gets there, he finds out that it's actually for sort of an experiment to learn about his new AI that he's created. He's created a full Android AI, and he wants to test it out on Domhnall Gleeson's character. This movie has a lot of twists and turns. It's extremely embedded in psychological sci-fi. And it's really, really well done. The effects in this movie are phenomenal. It won the Oscar for it, even though this is kind of a smaller film. Like, it's not even kind of, it definitely is a smaller film in comparison to the movies it was up against. If you like sci-fi, I really don't want to spoil anything, which is why I don't want to spend a lot of time on this movie, but if you like sci-fi, if you like movies that make you think and that are really strange and sort of out there, definitely give Ex Machina a chance because it's a very interesting and also extremely well done film. The next movie on the list goes along with Ex Machina, that is Under the Skin, starring Scarlett Johansson. I'm gonna say very little about this film because I really don't want to spoil anything. Basically, this is a movie about a woman who is luring men into secluded areas And the whole story is her sort of having a journey of self-discovery. This is a thinker of a movie. It's really creepy. It's almost scary. And I highly recommend it to people that like movies that are creepy and scary like that. It's not your traditional horror film, but it's also not your traditional thriller. I don't want to say anything more. All I can say is the score of this movie is amazing. Scarlett Johansson is amazing in it, and check this movie out. If you're someone that thought you would maybe be interested in Ex Machina, definitely check this movie out also. The next movie on the list is one that is sort of split. It is A Clockwork Orange, Stanley Kubrick's film about a dystopian Britain. We follow the character of Alex, who is this delinquent who commits these horrible crimes against people, while everyone in this society is drugged up and does things that we can't understand in our society, and he's arrested, and then goes into sort of psychotherapy for his insanity, but not everything that is involved in this psychotherapy necessarily works as planned on Alex. Again, this movie is one that is a thinker. Some people watch this film and instantaneously hate it. They don't give it a chance. They don't take the time to try and think about what it's actually trying to say. They just take it as smut and move on. Very similar to American Psycho, which I recommended in my Hulu video. This movie is extremely well done. Obviously, it's Kubrick, so you know that it will be very well done. But I recommend it to people because I think this is a film where if you can watch this and you can accept that it is a piece of art and it is a film, you can see just about any movie, which you don't have to necessarily like this film. I do. I think this is a good movie. I think it's a great movie. But there are a lot of people that respect this film, and that's the key. If you watch this film, remember that you need to respect the artistic form that is in it. I'm not going to try and spoil everything that's done, but there are some scenes that are rough to watch, but they're rough to watch for a reason if you think about what the whole story is telling you. The next film is another Oscar Isaac picture, that being Inside Llewyn Davis, directed by the Coen brothers. This is the story of a folk singer in the 1960s, and we basically just follow him for a week in his life of the ups and downs of trying to become a professional singer and become paid for what he does. There isn't a lot to say. This movie, that's it. This movie's a very plain, straightforward film about a man who is just trying to find his way in this world being a folk singer. The music in this movie is amazing. The soundtrack is so good. Everything about it is great. Oscar Isaac gives an Oscar-worthy performance in this film. He is phenomenal. The Coen brothers' direction is phenomenal. And the whole story, I think, is very well put together. Now, I've had a lot of pretty serious films on this list, and there are more serious films to come on this list, but I figured I should throw out at least a couple more fun, chill films. So the first one of those is Goon, starring Sean William Scott, most well known for being Stifler in the original American Pie films. This movie tells the story of a man who is a bouncer who's really good at fighting people. So he joins up on a minor league hockey team and ends up becoming the guy on their team that they call on when they need somebody to fight. So when someone on the other team is doing very well, or they're just well known for fighting, they have him go out there and basically just immediately hit them to start a fight, and then he wins because he's great at fighting. This movie's silly, it also has Jay Baruchel in it, it's a fun story, it's funny, and I'd recommend it to anyone that just likes dumb comedies, similar to American Pie, films like that. It fits into that category. It is funny, you'll get some laughs out of it, but you also don't have to, like, strictly pay attention to it, and as I've said with many of these other films, you don't really have to think about it that much. The next more fun film on the list is one that I watched at a younger age than I probably should have, that being Tremors, starring Kevin Bacon. This is the story of a small town out in the middle of nowhere that all of a sudden begins being terrorized by these prehistoric, like, ground worm monster things, and the premise is very silly, so because of that, the script is built around the idea that these characters are also sort of funny. There are funny moments throughout the film. The characters have silly little things about them that make you laugh, and the script is not taking itself too seriously, which is why this movie works the way it does. This movie has had like 4 or 5 sequels, I think, at this point that are all just awful. But the first one, it actually works as a fun-loving horror comedy film that I would recommend to people if they want to just watch something that's kind of silly, but at the same time maybe does have some suspenseful moments. The next movie that I want to recommend is one that I think I maybe saw in school the first time I ever watched it, but I've seen it more times since then. That is Apollo 13, directed by Ron Howard and starring Tom Hanks. It is the story of the actual Apollo 13 mission, which was sent to go land on the moon, but a bunch of stuff starts to go wrong with the spacecraft. So they are then trapped, basically. They can't land on the moon, but they also don't know how they're going to get back to Earth. So the movie shows these astronauts living in awful conditions up in space because they're having to conserve power and things, while NASA is down there doing everything that they can to try to solve this problem. But the most interesting aspect of this film is we also get to see from the point of view of the families of the astronauts and how worried they are and how scared they are. And the combination of these three things helps to make this film that much more interesting. Ron Howard also does a very good job directing the film, and it's written fairly well, and the fact that it's based on a true story helps add the extra suspense. I wasn't alive when this took place, so I didn't know the ending the first time I watched it, and if you don't know the ending, I'd recommend not looking it up before seeing the film because it makes it very suspenseful and it keeps you very involved in the story. The next film is Nicholas Winding Refn's follow-up to Drive, which is Only God Forgives, starring Ryan Gosling. Shocker, I know. It tells the story of a man living in Bangkok whose brother is murdered, and he decides to take it personally, as most people probably would, and decides to try and hunt down and find the person that committed the murder to find out why they did it, and maybe also murder them since they killed his brother. This movie is nowhere near as beloved as Drive is by critics, and I think, to be fair, not many movies are as good as Drive, but as a follow-up, I don't hate this film as much as many people do. I think that you have to think about it, and I think the main criticism it gets is how violent it is, and that's just how Nicholas Winding Refn makes films. His movies have hyper-violence in them, and if you don't like that, your odds are not gonna like the movie. So I don't understand why someone that wouldn't like hyperviolence would watch this film and then criticize it on the violence involved in it. I do admit, this movie is more violent than Drive is, but I think the violence throughout the film works for the most part. Maybe a couple moments go a little over the top, but not to the point where I think that it like ruins the film. The story has very interesting dichotomies between different characters. You have to think about this movie, just as many movies I've put on this list. It is very psychological, but it also has very well-shot fight scenes, and the neon lighting is amazing throughout the film. If you liked Drive, give this movie a chance. You probably won't like it as much as that film, but maybe you can respect it and understand what the story is about before you just immediately dismiss it on the amount of violence that is in it. The last film that I want to put on this list is Bone Tomahawk, starring Kurt Russell and Patrick Wilson. This movie came out last year and tells the story of a small town during the 1800s that is being attacked by a group of cannibalistic cave-dwelling troglodytes. They're basically just creatures that never fully evolved into Homo sapiens, so they don't have regular people's facial features or looks or general mindsets. They have no empathy, and they're cannibals. So the story is basically they attack a community and they kidnap a bunch of the members. So then a group of, you know, cowboys get together to go hunt them down. And this movie is a combination of a Western and a horror film. The beginning feels like a Western. The middle gets a little bit of the horror aspect, but then there's a long stretch that's very much a Western. But the last half hour to 45 minutes of this movie is terrifying. The antagonists of this film look super scary. There's constant suspense in the scenes that involve them. Every character is terrified by them. The way they communicate is disgusting, and the whole ending part of this movie is really, really riveting filmmaking in terms of horror. And if you like horror films, definitely watch this movie. If you like Westerns, check it out. But if you like it when movies combine two genres that aren't normally put together, watch this because it's done very well. Well, guys, that is my list of 10 movies to recommend on Amazon Instant Video. Again, if you are a student, I highly recommend signing up for this service for the free 6 months to see if you like it, to check out some movies, to watch whatever you want to, because it's all free for 6 months, plus you get 2 days shipping, so it's like totally worth it. If you enjoy any of the movies on this list, please leave a comment down below. Let me know what you like. Let me know what you didn't like. I love talking to you guys. As always, I'm Eric. If you enjoyed the video, please do like, subscribe, and I hope to see you guys later.